I would like to bring back up Dustin, Schein, and Dave Mehlman.
I'd like to thank the festival. This is a very wonderful place to be. I spent many hours here as a teenager watching movies in the balcony that doesn't exist anymore. So this feels like home. And I want to thank Dave and everybody here. There's so many people here who have helped make this possible.
I just thought I'd kick it off with a question of my own. How were you, I guess, first introduced to him? I don't mean like his legacy, but him personally, and how did you, I guess, talk him into the, was it difficult to get him on board film?
It was not difficult at all, but I met Mayer working on another film. I was making a film called No Impact Man. And Mayer was the community gardener growing vegetables, and we got to be friends, and he had a small part in that, but whenever I showed it, people wanted to know more about Mayer, and so did I. I mean, I grew up kind of idealizing the 60s activists, and this was a way for me to learn more about it. So after that film, I suggested we make a profile of him, thinking it was going to be like a Jewish Grey Gardens type situation, not knowing what was going to happen. So.
I have a question for the editor. How much film did you have to?
5,000 hours.
Really?
No, there were probably, what?
150 hours?
150 hours footage, and then maybe then archival on top of that. It was shot over such a long period of time that it was really trying to figure out how to create a sort of concise, tight-ish narrative out of it. And to sort of, you know, Mayer went through so many cycles, and to try to fit it really into one cycle that was sort of digestible was probably the biggest overall challenge.
I mean, I clearly had lost perspective, and I was really grateful to have Dave there to help shape the film and make the film. There's so much great material that didn't make it into the film, but just, you know, there's only so much Mayer in his underwear. And, it's about trying to balance the sadness and the humor and all those things to make the story.
I think the other tricky part was also we didn't know going in how much of Justin was going to be in it. And so it was figuring out the balancing of the Justin story and how to integrate that and to kind of get to it, and then the writing of it and the rewriting of it.
Yes, sir.
So many documentary film ethics issues. Were there any documentary ethics experts that you consulted on?
There is footage that I shot of me talking to a documentary ethicist and to lawyers, and that was helpful for me, but it, you know, in terms of the movie, it felt a little indulgent. So, I mean, as a documentary filmmaker, I'm fascinated, and that was one of the reasons why I wanted to make the film, continue to make the film, was because I feel like these challenges exist in every film, and this is so pronounced. So yes, I did seek the advice of a lot of colleagues and professionals.
Yes, sir.
Hi, first I'd like to congratulate you. I think you did an excellent job navigating that treacherous path that made a very subtle movie with a lot of nuances. And I think what makes it successful is that as you're sitting there, you think, what would I have done? And so my question was, aren't you obliged as a psychotherapist if someone says they want to kill themselves to have them committed? And so I noticed there was a guy whose face was blanked out. If Mayer's sitting there saying he wants to kill himself, isn't he obliged to, like, turn him over?
I don't know the specifics of that. I was surprised that, you know, when it became a little bit more clear that there wasn't more intervention, and I did ask Mayer about that, and Mayer's response was that he thought his psychiatrist was being brave, and that he knew that Mayer had been hospitalized before, and that it wasn't a humane response to his lifelong depression. And I spoke to the doctor about it, and Mayer had been talking about this for more than a decade, so it wasn't like a specific plan in place that I think, obligated him to act.
It's a much better documentary than I expected. Just let me start there.
Thank you.
And the fact that you were put into the film in the way that you were, you really represented the audience. The very questions that I think many of us were asking ourselves as we were watching the film. Tom and Farsad and Abby and now Mayor all committed suicide. And people like to play on that theme. And I think that Judy Gumbo is not one of my favorite people in the world, but her attitude about how she participates in life, as opposed to Mayor not being able to move ahead. And his addictions sort of were crutches to that. But it's a real lesson about how do you age, particularly when you've been so active and so committed to others. So I think that it must have been a very hard edit. It must have been a very hard ethical question constantly. And I just want to tell you that I felt your humanity throughout the film, the same way I felt with Paul Krasner. You know, the people that knew Mayer really well had been through this over and over and over. And at the end of the day, when you have nothing to live for, what is a friend to do? There were many interventions. They're not in the film. You know that there were. You know, but at the end of the day, Mayer had the right to do whatever he wanted to do with his life. And I think you put that up there on the screen. So thank you.
You are the real hero of the movement, was there from the beginning, and is, as opposed to Mayer, I mean, still going strong and very engaged in the world. So that means a lot to me. So thank you, Jim.
But I have curiosity, timing-wise, when you took the trip upstate, and took the cameras down from inside of his house and said, okay, I'm going to leave this alone for a minute. Was it during that trip that he called you and said, my apartment is trashed, I need help, I need someone to come? Did you have to abandon your trip earlier? Was that edited?
The question was the chronology of the taking out of the camera and the family trip upstate and whether or not he was in fact torn away prematurely.
I'm pretty sure that the trip upstate is when he called me, and is when he did that. It was
that was all pretty true.
July 4th weekend, and I think the case could be made that drinking two bottles of vodka is not a sincere suicide attempt. That maybe he was trying to get my attention and from my parenting. But yes, it was, and it was from there that I felt a certain disengagement with the world. I think there's no one suicide. I mean, the term suicide is a really broad term that doesn't necessarily do justice to the kind of intricacies of people's pain and situations. And in so many situations, young people, people who are not being treated by doctors, there's a lot that can be done to help them. And in other cases, you know, people make, I don't know if you can say a rational choice, but a clear-headed choice that might be fogged by pain.
He gets a lot of attention.
Yeah, no question that he was getting attention, and the fact that Abby and Tom both did this, and Phil Oakes, another friend of his, and there is this concept of suicide contagion, where if somebody in your life commits suicide, it dramatically increases your possibilities, because it opens it up as a possibility. So, you know, I think that, and then at its heart, this is lifelong depression, mental illness that came together. And then, you know, if you told Mayer you couldn't do something, it made it more interesting to him. So that didn't help, certainly. It's a film about a friendship. It's a film about the responsibilities we have to friends and loved ones who are in pain. It's a film about growing old. And also, I mean, I hope that this is a film that inspires young people to learn more about the movement. So those are some of the things.
Great. Well, thank you both very much for joining us.
Thank you.